FORA.tv, the world is thinking.
Now, if I were a politician, I'd probably be calling you folks right about now. And that's one word you're not going to hear from me tonight. I'd be happy to call you citizens or ladies and gentlemen or even human beings, but not folks, that word so beloved by every political candidate trying to prove that he or she is just one of the boys or just one of the girls. This word is a plague spread by the President of the United States, television anchors, radio talk show hosts, and anyone trying to demonstrate his or her identification with presumably wholesome, ordinary American values. Look up any important presidential speech in the history of the United States before 1980, and you won't find a single patronizing appeal to folks. Imagine, we here highly resolve that these folks shall not have died in vain, that this government of the folks, by the folks, and for the folks, you know the rest. In the 1950s, even though there were no orators of Lincoln's eloquence on the political scene, voters still expected their leaders to employ dignified, if not necessarily erudite speech. Adlai Stevenson may have, and he did, sound too much like an intellectual to suit the tastes of average Americans, but proper grammar and respectful forms of address were mandatory for anyone seeking high office. Now, Eisenhower was much mocked by intellectuals at the time, but he was a Demosthenes compared to what we're used to today. Now, the gold standard of presidential oratory for adult Americans in the 50s, when I was a kid, was the memory of Franklin Roosevelt, whose patrician accent in no way detracted from his extraordinary ability to make a direct connection with ordinary people. It's really impossible to read the transcripts of FDR's famous fireside chats and not mourn the passing of a civic culture that appealed to Americans to expand their knowledge and understanding instead of pandering to the lowest common denominator. Roosevelt would no more have addressed his fellow citizens as folks than he would have uttered an obscenity over the radio. At the end of 1940, attempting to prepare Americans for the coming of war and to tell them that America must become the arsenal of democracy, he spoke in characteristic terms, and I'd just like to read you a short passage from it. "Tonight, in the presence of a world crisis, my mind goes back 8 years to a night in the midst of a domestic crisis. I well remember that while I sat in my study in the White House, preparing to talk to the people of the United States, I had before my eyes the picture of all of those Americans with whom I was talking. I saw the workmen in the mills, the mines and the factories, the small shopkeeper, the farmer doing his spring plowing, the widows and old men wondering about their life savings. I tried to convey to the great mass of the American people what the banking crisis meant to them in their daily lives." These words have such dignity, such respect for the public he was talking to. They really make me want to weep, even though I've read them many times. And they ought to make us all want to weep, because when you substitute folks for people, farmers, old men, and widows, the relationship between the abandonment of dignified public speech and the degradation of the political process becomes clear. Now, we're not hearing much about America's intellectual problems during this campaign. To be too well informed, too educated, is to risk that most damning of charges, elitism. I mean, look at what we've seen in the Democratic primary race. The ridiculous spectacle of a Harvard Law School graduate and a former editor of the Harvard Law Review and a Yale Law School graduate trying to pretend that they're just one of the folks and arguing about who is more of an elitist. You know, by this logic, why not just bypass all college graduates and have an eighth grader or a high school graduate be president? You know, why not make it a requirement for the presidency that you not have gone to college?